Dear friends, welcome back. This is episode number 84 of the CPC. We are dealing with section 2.2, the definition of decree. We have read only the first part of section 2.2. Then we will continue. Decree means a formal expression which says it may be either preliminary or final. We stopped there. It continues. It shall be deemed to include. Deemed to include the rejection of a plaint and the determination of a question under section determination of any question within section 144, but shall not include. We will stop there. So it shall be deemed to include the rejection of a plaint and the determination of any question within section 144, but shall not include. We will stop there. There are two subclauses, A and B. We will stop there. Or we will read it then come back. But it shall not include any adjudication from which an appeal lies as an appeal from an order. Or any order of dismissal for default. So it shall be deemed to include the rejection of a plaint and decision under section 144, but shall not include a decision, an adjudication from which an appeal lies as an appeal from an order or any order for dismissal for default. Then there is an explanation. A decree is preliminary when further proceedings have to be taken before the suit can be completely disposed of. We have seen in the case of a partition suit. It is final when such adjudication completely disposes of the suit. It may be partly preliminary and partly final. Now it is clear what is preliminary decree and final decree. Now we will come to the second part of 2.2. Deemed to include but shall not include. Deemed to include what? Rejection of a plaint. Where do you get rejection of plaint? Under Order 7, Rule 11. We will see Order 7, Rule 11. See, these are all interconnected. So, I am saying this to the beginner, please bear with me. The seniors and the semi-seniors, please forgive me. Beginners, how they have to study CPC is that you have to find out what are all the connections. A particular section or a particular order, rule in an order may be connected with so many other things. So you will find the answer there. Sometimes it may be specifically mentioned here. Sometimes it may not be specifically mentioned. You have to find out. For example, section 51 contains several clauses. Each clause is pregnant with several other provisions which are not mentioned there. You have to find out. And then note it. Then only the study will be complete. So that the CPC can be studied not by reading section 1 to end. It is by reading the relevant provisions and then finding out the connection between that section and various other orders and rules and various other sections also. Sometimes some other provisions in another statute may be relevant. So you have to have a knowledge of all those things, practical knowledge of those things. Nobody can be a pundit. But a practical application of the CPC, once you know the technique, it is very easy. Otherwise, it is a difficult subject. Don't be afraid of CPC. CPC, I used to say, is your friend. So apply, approach CPC as you are approaching, you are talking to your friend. So understand your friend properly. Then he will be indeed a good friend. Likewise, understand the CPC. Understand the scope of application of the various provisions. Understand the connection between the various provisions. And then apply it. It will help you. CPC will become your friend. Then Order 7. Order 7, Rule 11. I mentioned about rejection of plaint. Order 7, Rule 11. Just I will mention what it is. under order 7 you may note rule 10 provides for return of plaint and rule 11 provides for rejection of plaint. Both are different. The application is, the consequences are also different. Return of plaint is an order. Rejection of plaint is deemed to be a decree. It is not a decree really, but deemed to be a decree. Rejection of plaint. The plaint shall be rejected in the following cases. There are up to clause F. A, where it does not disclose a cause of action. Where the plaint does not show a cause of action, it can be rejected straight away by the court. Where the relief claimed is undervalued and the plaintiff being required by the court to correct the valuation within the time fixed by the court fails to do so. For every suit, there is a valuation. There may be either fixed valuation or ad valorem valuation. I am filing a suit against you for realization of rupees 1 lakh. What is the valuation of the suit? 1 lakh. So on that, court fee has to be paid. There are fixed court fees. There are methods of valuation under the particular Court Fees and Suit Valuation Act of which are applicable to your state. Every state will have a Court Fee and Suit Valuation Act or Court Fees Act as the case may be. So that also you have to study. What is a court fee payable? Court fee payable in Bombay is not court fee payable in Madras. Court fee payable in Kerala. All are different. So that the Court Fees Act also becomes relevant. So where the relief is undervalued and the court directs you to correct his evaluation, but you do not do it, you do not obey, plaint can be rejected. Where the relief claimed is properly valued, but the plaint is written upon paper insufficiently stamped, and the plaintiff on being required by the court to supply the requisite stamp paper within a time to be fixed by the court fails to do so. It is properly valued. So I said 1 lakh, all right. Court fee is payable at a particular rate. I do not pay the required court fee. Court asked me to pay, but I failed to pay. Plaint can be rejected. Where the suit appears from the statement of the plaint to be barred by any law. I file a suit on the basis of a promissory or agreement that is dated, suit for realization of money. That is dated 1-1-2005. I filed the suit when? In 2020. 5 years elapsed. Normally, the Limitation Act provides for a period of limitation for such suits for 3 years. It's a period of limitation. So on a mere look at the plaint, it is clear that the suit is barred by limitation. It is based on a promissory note dated 1-1-2015. Suit is filed in 2020. 3 years is the period of limitation. It is barred by time, barred by limitation. So, where the suit appears from the statement in the plaint to be barred by any law, or a dispute between husband and wife, a family matter, matrimonial issue, custody of children or divorce, is the relief claimed. The Family Courts Act provides that it is only the family court and not the civil court that will have jurisdiction. So it is barred by the Family Courts Act. Plaint can be rejected. Need not go for a trial. Why should the opposite party be oppressed about it? Why should he undertake the ordeal of a long trial? Need not. The court will reject it then and there. Where it is not filed in duplicate, that is a new provision added in 2002 amendment. See, when you file a plaint, it shall be filed in duplicate. If it is not done, it will be rejected. See, a highly technical thing. But the court will provide you sufficient opportunity to do it. Where the plaintiff fails to comply with the provisions of Rule 9, that is also within such and such time something is to be done. That is Rule 9. Rule 9 provides for what? It is sufficient copies, etc. So those are all should not have been included in Rule 11. But unfortunately, procedure on admitting the plate when the court orders that the summons plaintiff sufficient copies necessary for service to the opposite side must be filed within 7 days. If you do not do it, and if the plaint is rejected, it will have very serious consequences. What is the consequence? If a plaint is rejected, it shall be deemed to be a decree. Deemed to be a decree means if you want to challenge it, you can do it 2 ways. One is to file an appeal. Appeal, you have to pay the same court fee. Or file a review, half the court fee. So suppose a suit is valued at 20 lakhs or 50 lakhs, huge court fee will be there. Suppose your plaint is rejected on the ground that you did not file the plaint in duplicate or did not submit the necessary number of copies to be served on the opposite side, your plaint is rejected. That will be very, very harsh. Normally, the court will not do it unless and until sufficient opportunity is provided to correct the mistake. Otherwise, the parties will be put to peril. Serious consequences are there. So, finding such consequences, and in our state, what happened is that the Court Fees Act was amended and a provision was made that along with the plaint, you need pay only 1/10 of the court fee. The balance 9/10 can be paid within 15 days after settlement of issues. Likewise, appeals. You need pay 1/3 of the court fee along with the memorandum of appeal and the balance can be paid within 15 days of the date of admission. Then the balance court fee is to be paid. And many a times, the balance court fee will not be paid within time. Suppose the plaint is to be rejected in such case or the appeal is to be rejected in such case, the parties will be put to great difficulty. The court will provide time, court will warn you that I will do it. So, fail to comply with the provisions of Rule 9. These are all the grounds on which a plaint can be rejected. If a plaint is rejected, it is deemed to be a decree. So, when the Court Fees Act was amended, such cases increased in number. Then to tackle that difficulty, our High Court, Kerala High Court held, a division bench held, another division bench also later held, that an appeal from a decision rejecting the plaint for non-payment of the balance court fee is only an order. And therefore, court fee for the purpose of appeal need be only the fixed court fee which is contained in the particular article. And that is 10 rupees or 15 rupees. Such a method was found out to save the litigants. Really, it is a decree, deemed to be a decree. Yes. Then, it shall be deemed to be included rejection of a plaint and determination of any question within section 144. What is 144? Restitution. Restitution putting the parties in the same position which he would have occupied but for certain events. Let us see 144. Just a cursory look at it. Not a full study. Application for restitution. When an order is varied or reversed in appeal, revision or other proceeding, or is set aside or modified in a suit instituted for the purpose, then what will happen? The court which passed the decree shall, on the application of the party entitled to the benefit by way of restitution or otherwise, cause such restitution to be made, how? As will, as far as may be, place the parties in the position which would have occupied for such decree or order. They would have occupied but for such decree or order. I will give an example. I filed a suit against you for recovery of possession of an item of immoral property. The suit is decreed by the trial court. Decree is there. I can execute the decree and oust you. Get back possession. But you have got a right of appeal. I need not wait for your right of appeal. But the execution will be levied only after the appeal period is over. Normally it is so. Notice will be issued, then otherwise parties will be put to great difficulty. You file an appeal, you did not get a stay. You file an appeal, but you did not get a stay. What will happen? Does it prevent me from getting the decree executed? No. I can get the decree executed. I got the decree executed and got back possession of the property from you by the process of the court. And later in the appeal, you succeeded. My suit for recovery of possession was dismissed. And by that time, the property came to me. How do you get back the property? Should you file a separate suit? No, it is not necessary. You need only make an application to the court for restitution. Put you in the same position which you would have been placed, but for such decree or order. So what is the decree? Which decree which was granted by the trial court for recovery of possession was set aside in appeal, reversed in appeal, and I would not get a decree for recovery of possession, but for the fact that the trial court wrongly granted a decree in my favor, pending appeal, I got possession of the property in execution since you did not get a stay. You should not lose that property. After the appellate decree, you can apply to the court stating, requesting you to put back in possession of the property, which otherwise a position which you would have occupied but for the execution of the decree. This restitution. It's a long section explanation is there. I am not going to the details of it. Just mentioning restitution, what it is. But shall not include, so it shall be deemed to include rejection of plaint and determination of a question under section 144. That is, rejection of plaint is a deemed decree. Restitution order, it is a deemed decree. But it shall not include any adjudication from which an appeal lies as an appeal from an order. What is it? For which we have to see what is order. What is order? Section 214. Defines order means the formal expression of a decision of a civil court which is not a decree. Here mention of a civil court is made. Formal expression of a decision of a civil court which is not a decree. It is an order. Then judgment, section 29. Judgment means the statement given by the judge on the grounds of a decree or order. So, the judgment is the thing which contains the reasoning and the points for adjudication and the text of the whole crux of adjudication. Detailed one. Reasons must be stated. A judgment is not my decision that matters. I decide. That will be dictating. Just like a dictator does it. How I decide, I must express. I am deciding your case and another man's case between you and another man. So I write a judgment. I decide in favor of the plaintiff. I decide in favor of the defendant. Is it sufficient? No. Why, how I come to that conclusion must be reflected in the judgment. That is the judgment, not the just conclusion. And the conclusive part of it will be contained in the decree. So an adjudication from which an appeal lies from an appeal from an order, what is it? So an order is there. An adjudication from which an appeal lies as an appeal from an order, which is not a decree. An adjudication from which an appeal lies as an appeal from an order, section 104 and order 43. It is not a decree. Section 104 and order 43. You have to read. Section 104 says that the following order's appeal lies. And order 43, see, detailed part of it. Order 43 rule 1 contains which are the appealable orders. 104. Every decree is appealable, every order is not. Every decree is appealable because of section 96. Every order is not appealable because the orders which are provided in section 104 and order 43 rule 1 alone are appealable. An interlocutory order, say for a temporary injunction, it is appealable because order 43 rule 1 provides for an appeal. Section 104. An appeal shall lie from the following orders and save otherwise expressly provided in the body of this code or any law for the time being in force from no other orders. Then various things are mentioned there. Likewise, order 43 rule 1. Any order for dismissal for default, you see order 9. So section 22 contains order 7, rule 11, section 104, order 43 and order 9. These are all to be read together, so that you master it. Likewise, we have to study it. We will see in the next episode. I will mention the decisions of section 2.2 in various coming episodes. So that it is not the just explaining what a decree, under what all circumstances this definition of decree becomes important. So various shades of meaning. So I will give those citations, otherwise you will not be able to collect all those details and then apply to each case. So we will go to this under, put all these things under the head decree. We will come back. Thank you.